You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good.
Good morning. Welcome to Live Oak. If you'll go ahead and stand up, we're going to sing. 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, God is faithful, he who has called you into fellowship with his son, Jesus Christ. So he's inviting us to engage with him this morning. And so let's sing and worship him and sing of his faithfulness.
Blood has brought us into freedom. There is no other that can save us, 'cause we know, yes we know, it is Jesus. He is always with us, faithful and true. In our weakness, he is bringing us through. There's only one who never fails us, 'cause we know, yes we know, it is Jesus. 'Cause we know, yes we know, it is Jesus. Oh, he is always with us, faithful and true. In our weakness, he is bringing us through. Highway through the valley, always with us, faithful and true. What could come against the love of Jesus? Who would dare stand in his way?
Everybody, how's it going? We're still sleeping, this weather? Yeah? That's cool. Well, welcome in this morning. We're glad to see everybody. If you're new here at Live Oak, we just want to say a special welcome to you. before you leave, make sure you stop by the Connect table. We have a special gift just for you coming for your first time. And if you've been coming for a while and you're interested in becoming a member, we'd love to talk to you back at the Connect desk as well. Here at Live Oak, we exist to see people transformed through Jesus Christ. So, yeah, we'd love to talk to you over there and get you connected. So, yeah, a couple of announcements. One, November 3rd is our child dedication. So we would love, if you have a child that you would want to be dedicated, we would love to talk to you about that. But also, if you don't and you're just part of the church, we really want you to be here. Here at Live Oak, child dedication is a commitment between parents and the church community. Parents commit to raise their child or children in the name of Jesus Christ and his way of life as revealed in Scripture. And it's also the church community committing to come alongside the parents. So as a community, we would love for you to be here to be a part of that. The next thing is Operation Christmas Child. So we started this last week. Does anybody remember our goal? 100. There we go. So our goal is to pack 100 shoeboxes. And this just sends a Christmas gift to children all over the world. But more than that, it allows us the opportunity to share the message of Jesus Christ with those who don't get it any other way. So we would love for you to grab a shoebox if you haven't already. Pack it. There's packing instructions inside. And we just ask that you bring it back by November 17th. That's the cutoff. So make sure you get it back by then. Again, goal is 100. We can do it. So yeah, that's coming up. Got to turn the page. Ladies, your Women's Work and Calling Conference is coming up. It is Friday, November 1st from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. at Christ the King Church. And it's an opportunity for you to get together, have some fellowship and community with other women to explore how to integrate faith into work and just life in general. So it's going to be great. The cost is $40 per lady, so make sure you sign up before you go. And again, that is November 1st. And then next week, guess what time it is? Potluck brunch. Whoop, whoop. It's getting better every time. I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but the food is increasingly getting better, and there's becoming more of it, so everybody gets to eat. So that is coming up next Sunday, so bring your favorite brunch and just hang out with us after. Have a good meal. And then if you want to give to Live Oak, there are a couple ways to do that. One is the giving box in the back. You can give using the Church Center app. You can download that right in front of you. Or you can give online. So there are a couple ways to do that. And then last but not least, is Mr. Brian Few in here? Brian? Bueller? Brian, we need you. This isn't planned, so he has no idea what's going on, as you can tell. So if you don't know what October is, it is Pastor Appreciation Month. And we couldn't let this month go by without appreciating our pastor. So go ahead and give him a hand. So just stand there awkwardly. You're doing great. We just want to say, okay, don't make it too awkward. We just want to say thank you for all that you do for us as a church. If you're new here, you haven't seen it yet, but you probably will. Brian goes above and beyond, not just to minister to us as a church, but also individually. And he does that in such a great way, and his leadership is unmatched. So thank you for all that you do for us. And just for you, my friend, we have a special gift for your favorite place, good old Moe's Barbecue. Oh, you need that. Don't forget that. And then also, I don't know if Lindsay's here yet, but it's also her birthday. So give Lindsay a shout out as well. So he gets a gift and celebrate Lindsay as well. Okay, that's it. Yeah, thank you. Stand up, greet somebody, or come everybody rush Brian and tell him how thankful you are for him. Don't do that.
worship. Sing How Great Is Our God, the splendor.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice.
discouraging to go through something like that again when you think you're past it. But something that has been really encouraging for me is just remembering how God brought me through it last time and just knowing that he's walking through it with me again. I think it's really easy to get discouraged and feel abandoned and like God's not with you. But I think this next song is just a really good reminder that he's not going to leave us. He'll never forsake us. He's always with us. So let's sing together. The place where you promised to be. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? As I walk now through the valley, let your love above every fear, like the sun shaping the shadow in my weakness, your glory appears. I'm not enough unless you come. All I
All right, thanks, guys. Thanks, Sam. All right, we're going to start today reading Revelation 14. So if you guys are ready to get weird, I'm ready. The Lamb and the 144,000. Then I saw the Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him were 144,000 who had his name and his Father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a sound from heaven like the roar of mighty ocean waves or the rolling of loud thunder. It was like the sound of many harpists playing together. This great choir sang a wonderful new song in front of the throne of God and before the four living beings and the 24 elders. No one could learn this song except the 144,000 who had been redeemed from the earth. They have kept themselves as pure as virgins, following the Lamb wherever he goes. They have been purchased from among the people on the earth as a special offering to God and to the Lamb. They have told no lies, and they are without blame. Now the three angels. And I saw another angel flying through the sky, carrying the eternal good news to proclaim to the people who belong to this world, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. Fear God, he shouted. Give glory to him, for the time has come when he will sit as judge. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all the springs of water. Then another angel followed him through the sky, shouting, Babylon is fallen, that great city is fallen, because she made all the nations of the world drink the wine of her passionate immorality. Then a third angel followed them, shouting, Anyone who worships the beast in his statue or who accepts his mark on the forehead or on the hand must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured full strength into God's cup of wrath, and they will be tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. The smoke of their torment will rise forever and ever, and they will have no relief day or night, for they have worshiped the beast and his statue and have accepted the mark of his name. This means that God's holy people must endure persecution patiently, obeying his commands and maintaining their faith in Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, Write this down. Blessed are those who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they are blessed indeed, for they will rest from their hard work, for their good deeds follow them. And now the harvest of the earth. Then I saw a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was someone like the Son of Man. He had a gold crown on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Then another angel came from the temple and shouted to the one sitting on the cloud, Swing the sickle, for the time of harvest has come. The crop on earth is ripe. So the one sitting on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the whole earth was harvested. After that, another angel came from the temple in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. Then another angel, who had the power to destroy with fire, came from the altar. He shouted to the angel with the sharp sickle, Swing your sickle now to gather the clusters of grapes from the vines of the earth, for they are ripe for judgment. So the angel swung his sickle over the earth and loaded the grapes into the great winepress of God's wrath. The grapes were trampled in the winepress outside the city, and blood flowed from the winepress in a stream about 180 miles long and as high as a horse's bridle.
I figured if I came up here real quickly, Ashley wouldn't say anything crazy. Thank you, Ashley, for reading. You did a great job. Let's pray and we'll get into the message. Jesus, thank you so much for your love and your compassion and your mercy that you've poured out on us through your sacrifice on the cross. Thank you for the fact that we can know you in such a personal way. I pray that today, as we come in here, we have all different kinds of pressures and burdens and things in our mind that are weighing us down. I pray that you would meet us here because we have come to worship you. We've come to come to you as the source of life. We pray that you would meet us here. I pray that you would speak clearly through this message, through Revelation. You would make it make sense to us, and you would help us to leave here with clear action steps. And ask all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. All right, so if you haven't been here, if you're new, we've been in the middle of the book of Revelation, and we're going through it. We're in it. And what you need to know about this, and I think you would agree, is Revelation is difficult to read. Would anybody agree with that? It's pretty challenging. You have to do work. And so what we're trying to do is kind of hold the line or lean into this tension of doing enough Bible study to understand the message, but also, you know, going, what does it mean? What's the application here? What does this actually mean for today? And so it's a lot of work to do that. And so that's what we're, the way we're trying to approach this. And also, we're trying to approach this book with humility. There's lots of great perspectives, different perspectives that have a lot of good reason and thought behind them. But we're looking at this like we don't know exactly what it means. But what's been cool about this is every chapter, to me, has a clear message that is applicable for us today. So that's kind of the thought and approach behind our way of looking at Revelation. So today we're in chapter 14, and we're looking at three different visions that John had. And so let's walk through those visions. You just heard Ashley read through all of them. Let's walk through them. First, we're in Revelation verses 1 through 5 of chapter 14. He says, "Then I saw the Lamb standing on the Mount Zion. With him were 144,000 who had his name and his father's name written on their forehead. And I heard a sound from heaven like the roar of a mighty ocean waves of rolling loud thunder. It was like the sound of many harpists playing together. This great choir, a wonderful new song in front of the throne of God and before the four living beings and the 24 elders. No one could learn this song except the 144,000 who had been redeemed from the earth. They had kept themselves pure as virgins following the Lamb wherever he goes. They have been purchased from among the people on the earth as a special offering to God and the Lamb, and they have told no lies, and they are without blame." And so what we have here in this first vision, it's another glimpse of heavenly worship or worship in heaven before the throne of God. And it lists out all these different characters that were there. There was God, the Father, God, the Son, God, the Spirit. So these four living beings that were mentioned earlier in Revelation were there. The 24 elders and their thrones were there. Then it has those 144,000 believers from the earth were there in heaven. And we've talked about this already. Just going to say, people debate, who are those 144,000? Some believe they might be the 144,000 Jews that will be saved during the seven-year tribulation period right before Jesus comes back. Others see that number as not a literal number, but it represents all the believers who have been redeemed by God. And I love the way it describes that. It says the Father and the Son's names were written on their forehead. They had been sealed by God. They had been protected and marked by God. And so to me, the point of this little vision, which is really encouraging, we're going through the book of Revelation, and Revelation is so intense. There's some really kind of scary images about what could happen in the future. And so this is one of those reminders, this little vision. Basically, God is saying, hey, if you were sealed in Jesus Christ and you were marked by the Father, you will be preserved to the end. It's a little reminder right in the middle of all this craziness that we're reading about. It's saying, I will take you no matter how much you suffer on this earth, and you will suffer. No matter how many difficult things you go through, at the end of your life, you will be in heaven with God and you will be preserved by God. And it's an encouraging message, especially when you're going through hard times today, because hope is about looking forward. And when you're down and depressed, you're hopeless because you can't see a better future. You think this is it. This is all there is. This brokenness, this heartbreak is real, and this is what my life is going to be like. But this is a little reminder to say, no, no, no. Even if you lose your life in a painful way, which to me is the worst thing that could happen, maybe a slow, slow, painful death would be the worst. I want a quick death. Let a rock fall on my head. But just a slow, painful death, even if you face that, in the end, you will be preserved if you know Jesus. That's the message here in the beginning of this vision, and it's an encouraging message. Then we get to the heaviness of Revelation. The next vision is verses 6 through 13, if you're following along. And again, if you're new, we have detailed study notes right on the liveoak.org on the front page. You can check those out. But this is verses 6 through 13. It says, and I saw another angel flying through the air, carrying the eternal good news, the gospel, to proclaim to the people who belong to the world, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. Fear God, he shouted. Give glory to him. For the time has come when we will stand or sit as judges. Worship him and he who made heaven and earth, the sea and all the things in the water. Then another angel followed him through the sky, shouting, Babylon has fallen, that great city has fallen, because he made all the nations of the world drink the wine of her passionate immorality. Then a third angel followed them, shouting, anyone who worships the beast and his statue, or who accepts the mark on his forehead or on the hand, must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured full strength into God's cup of wrath. And they will be tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. The smoke of their torment will rise forever and ever, and they will have no relief day or night. For they have worshipped the beast and his statue and have accepted his mark of allegiance, his name. This means that God's holy people must endure persecution patiently, obeying his commands and maintaining their faith in Jesus. And I heard the voice from heaven saying, write this down. Blessed are those who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they are blessed indeed, for they will rest from their hard work, for their good deeds will follow them. And so with this vision, there's three angels, and each angel announces something to the world. And so let's walk through it real quick. The first angel announced the good news of Jesus Christ to the whole world and God's judgment to everyone who doesn't receive the good news. So on one hand, it's, hey, salvation is available. Mercy is available. Forgiveness is available. Christ has made it available to everyone. But you also need to know about the reality of God's judgment. We can't ignore that even though we like to. So he proclaims both. And one little interesting point to me is that I'll mention later, but is that in all this judgment, God is so merciful that he gives us an opportunity to turn back to him right up till the end. It's like most people don't give, you know, after a few times of messing up, it's over. But God gives us an opportunity right up to the end to turn back to him and to call on his name and be saved. That is incredible mercy. We'll talk more about this in a little bit. The second angel, this is interesting. This was a foreshadowing about what was coming in this vision and in the future. It says it was an announcement about the fall of Babylon. What you need to understand here is what is Babylon? Because he's referencing something we hadn't heard yet in Revelation. There's a whole chapter, two chapters on Babylon. But what is Babylon? Originally, the original Babylon was the ancient city. It was a real city in history. This isn't like Hobbit history. This is like real history. It was an ancient city of the Babylonian Empire. And the Babylonians, they conquered Judah of Israel. And then they took the Jews and they exiled them back to Babylon. That's what they were known for. And so they've been this kind of archetype or representation of all cities that are evil, of all cities that are probably, if you looked at them, you go, man, what do those cities represent? Well, they're marked by materialism. They're marked by power corruption. They're marked by sexual immorality. And so Babylon, throughout history, people would always refer to Babylon as any city that is marked by those evil things. It's a representation of all cities like that. And so back in John's day, John wrote Revelation. He was probably thinking of Rome when he wrote this. Rome as Babylon, because Rome definitely fit that description. But what's being talked about and announced by this angel when he says the fall of Babylon, he's announcing the fall of a future Babylon that represents humanity on earth. It's going to come to an end. And so that's a little preview of these two chapters we're going to look at in the next couple of weeks. But it represents human progress and the evil corruption that happens in cities. That's what he's announcing there. The third angel came and announced anyone who worshiped the beast. We talked about this last week. If you missed last week, you should go back and listen. We named which presidential candidate is the beast and when the end of the world is going to be. You should check it out. It's on the website. I don't want to spoil it for you. If you don't know me, I'm totally joking. I'll get an email later. What are you doing? I was like, joking. Where's your sense of humor? The third angel announced about the beast and receiving the mark of allegiance would face the judgment of God. And it's intense. It says they would drink the wine of God's anger from the cup of wrath. They will be tormented with fire and sulfur, and there will be no relief day and night. And so he's given this description. We're going to talk about this in a second here, but it's starting to like, that's not a verse you want to like lead with or like, hey, you should become a Christian. Let me tell you why. Because if you don't, you're going to face the cup of wrath and blood is going to flow. It's like, it's important to talk about that, but it's probably not the leading line, right? But as Christians, we need not to avoid reality. And John in Revelation takes us to reality. And so we got to go, what is going on here? Why is this so intense? Why is this so harsh? And so we'll get there. But this whole section about these three angels with these three announcements, one of the good news and God's judgment, one about the fall of Babylon, and one about a warning, if you worship the beast, you will face God's judgment. Then at the end, he says, listen up. God's people must endure persecution. You're going to suffer. You got to endure persecution. You need to obey his commands. You need to maintain your faith even when it's hard. And if you're put to death for your faith, if you die in his name, you will be considered blessed and you will receive eternal rest. I love that because it's a comparison to the judgment. The judgment, it said, they will experience all this pain and suffering. They will not rest day or night. But the reward for being faithful and knowing Jesus is eternal rest. Or rest from all your work. And so he points that out. And so this is just a generous warning to us. It's a warning about a coming reality that you should not ignore, even though it's easy to ignore. So then the last section here is verse 14 through 20. He says, then I saw a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was someone like the Son of Man. He had a gold crown on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Then another angel came from the temple and shouted to the one sitting on the cloud, swing the sickle, for the time of the harvest has come. The crop on the earth is ripe. So the one sitting on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the whole earth was harvested. After that, another angel came from the temple in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. Then another angel who had the power to destroy a fire came from the altar, and he shouted to the angel with a sharp sickle, "Swing your sickle now to gather the clusters of grapes from the vines of the earth, for they are ripe for judgment." So the angel swung his sickle over the earth and loaded the grapes into the great winepress of God's wrath. And the grapes were trampled in the winepress outside the city, and the blood flowed from the winepress in a stream about 180 miles long, as high as a horse's bridle. That is gnarly. And so what's going on in this vision? Again, this vision, it's the vision of the great harvest. And it, most people believe it represents the final day of judgment, where every human being, believer or not, will stand before the throne of God and be judged by God. And so this is a theme that's been throughout Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament. Jesus told a similar story about separating the good seed from the weeds and harvesting them, separating them and then burning the weeds. And so this is a theme, but it's an illusion. It's a story about God's final day of judgment. And so there's two reapers here. The first harvest, two harvests, two reapers. The first harvest and the reaper, it represents Jesus, because it says the one like the Son of Man was holding the reaper. Jesus gathering faithful followers from the earth. He's rescuing them. The second harvest is another angel as a reaper. And this angel is gathering unbelievers to face God's judgment. And this is where it gets uncomfortable. I didn't even want to talk about this because it's like, man, we could just blow through this real quick and ignore it. But I think we got to lean in and go, what is the heart of God in this crazy description we're about to read? So this second angel is collecting, gathering the unbelievers to face God's judgment. I'm like, let's put a period there. That sounds okay enough, face God's judgment. But then he gets really descriptive. And here's what it says. Facing the winepress of God's wrath, his anger, where they were trampled and blood flowed into the streets. One thing I will say, just as a side funny note to make us laugh for a second before we cry, is we've been going through this study and we're like, hey, some people believe this. Hey, other perspectives believe this. Hey, another perspective believes this. And real intense about these different perspectives. And one of the perspectives is seeing Revelation as symbolism. Everything is not literal. It just represents something else. And then there's a perspective that is super literal. 144,000 is 144,000. But as I was reading the study notes on this, and you get super deep on this, way down rabbit trails, the literal guys really had a hard time defining this one. They're like, how can blood flow for 180 miles and 6 feet tall, or as tall as a horse's bridle? How is this literal? And they're thinking through this and trying to explain it. And then scientists are like, well, that's more blood than all humans combined. So is this literal? And so most of them realize probably not literal. We're going to take this one as figurative, but everything else is literal. If you're a nerd and you care about study, it's funny. Let's get back to the judgment. Lindsay's going to be like, hey, that's one of those things you should have just shared with me, and I would have laughed with you. All right, so then he goes to the great winepress of God's wrath, and all this stuff happened. But here's what's going on here. This is a reference to the Old Testament. And there's multiple references here, but two of them are this, and the references are kind of worse. Isaiah 63, and then also I think it's in Joel. But in Isaiah 63, it says, why are your clothes so red as if you have been treading out the grapes? And then the response is, I've been treading the winepress alone. No one was there to help me. In my anger, I have trampled my enemies as if they were grapes. Their blood has stained my clothes, for the time has come to me to avenge my people, to ransom from their oppressors. I was amazed to see that no one intervened to help the oppressed. So I myself had to step in and save them. With my strong arm and my wrath, it sustained me as I was helping them. And then it says, I crushed the nations in my anger, and I made them stagger and fall, or I made them drunk on my wrath, spilling the blood upon the earth. That's intense. And so what I want to do is spend the rest of the time talking about this tension of how God can be a loving God and be full of anger and judge so harshly. Because that's such a stumbling block for people to deal with. And I want to spend the time going there. But here's what, so we've walked through Revelation 14. That's what it says. And those are some basic meanings from it. But one thing that just jumps off the page of Revelation 14 when I'm reading it, read it over and over and over, like, what is the message here? The message is super clear. And it's not a popular message, but it's this, is God's judgment is real. God's judgment is real for everyone who doesn't know him. Just take that right there. God's judgment is real for everyone who doesn't know him. But his great love and mercy is available to anyone who calls on his name, the name of Jesus Christ. His judgment is real and you cannot get away from it. But his mercy and his love is available to everyone who calls on his name for salvation. It's so amazing. We got to get into this detail here. But that's the main message that jumps off the page at me. And we see it in a couple places. But first, what is God's judgment? You know, what does that mean? I think his judgment is the natural consequences of rebelling against God. Like, a lot of times we like to just say, you know, it's not a big deal. It's not a big deal. We make excuses for things. But God's judgment is like gravity. When his creation has rebelled against him, there is a natural consequence. And that's what we'll talk about. But God's judgment is a natural consequence for rebelling against God. The Bible says it this way, and it says it in so many places. These are just two. In Romans 1:32, it says, God's justice requires that anyone who sins against God and humanity deserves to die. I don't like that, but that's what the natural consequence of sin is. It also says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God through Jesus Christ is eternal life. I love how the judgment is always put right beside his mercy. But judgment is the natural consequence of rebelling against God, and there's no way to get around it. But Revelation 14 clearly shows us God's judgment. And just two samplings of what we just read. The first is in verses 9 through 10. Anyone who worships the beast and his statue, who accepts the mark on his forehead or on his hand, must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured full strength into God's cup of wrath. You know what's interesting about the cup of wrath? This is what's so amazing about the good news of Jesus Christ. Because we're like, the cup of wrath, like, God has to deliver the cup of wrath against sinners. But you know what Jesus did? And this is what's so beautiful about the gospel. He drank the cup of wrath on the cross when he gave his life for your sin and my sin. So you see these themes of these Old Testament themes of the cup of wrath and the grapes being pressed in the wine press and all this blood flowing, but Jesus stepped in and took the cup of wrath. It's amazing. But let's stick to the judgment. I'm getting ahead of myself. And they were tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and of the Lamb. The smoke of their torment will rise forever and ever, and they will have no relief day or night. And then down at the bottom, verses 18 through 20, swing your sickle, for they are ripe for judgment. So the angel swung his sickle over the earth and loaded with grapes into the great winepress of God's wrath. The grapes were trampled in the winepress outside of the city, and the blood flowed from the winepress in a stream of about 180 miles and as high as a horse's bridle. How can a loving God be so angry and judge so harshly? How can a loving God be so angry and judge so harshly? I think this is a fair question, because when you read about God's judgment, it's intense. It can be hard to understand and to accept. It can be a stumbling block for us to go, you know, I love when I read about Jesus in the Gospels, Jesus washing people's feet. I love about Jesus helping those who are vulnerable. I love the gospel story and the message that Jesus sacrificed his life for the world, and anyone who believes in him can receive eternal life. I love that message. But I have a hard time with this judgment message, that there is a natural consequence for rebelling against God and harming his creation with humanity. So it's a fair question because it's hard to grasp. And so what some people have done, I think their intentions are good, but it's the wrong approach. Some people have tried to resolve this tension of God's love, his anger, and his judgment by softening his anger and judgment. They try to give Jesus a public relations campaign and make him a little softer and only highlight the positive verses and only talk about that, but ignore the other side of his character. And there's a problem with this view. And so what they say is this, is that, hey, God is not that angry. Sure, he gets mad every once in a while, but he's not that angry. All that stuff in the Old Testament of God's wrath, we leave that in the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. It's all sweet golden doodles and Labradors and sheep and beautiful things, vanilla candles. I don't know. It's not that Old Testament stuff. That was like Jesus 1.0. We're in the 2.0 in the New Testament. They try to soften and say God's not that angry. And that here's the, and then in the end, you're not going to face God's judgment. Everybody wins in the end. Love wins in the end. We're all just taken care of. There's been books written about that. One of them's called Love Wins. But the problem with that is that's a whole other religious system called universalism. That's not Christianity. That's blending universalism where there are no consequences and all roads lead to God and we're all just on different roads to God. But Jesus broke that down when he said, Jesus is so annoying because he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So we got to throw that argument out. I like the other argument. It sounds very generous. But Jesus himself is like, hey, I can't be on the sticker of coexist because I'm the only way. These other guys don't get it done. And so they try to soften his anger and his wrath by saying it's all good in the end. And God's not that angry, but it's not true. His own testimony proves differently. So what does that leave us with? If we're going to be serious about reading Revelation and reading Scripture and not watering it down or deleting it, how are we going to answer the question, how is God both loving and also delivers harsh judgment? How do we handle this? How do we resolve the tension? What I want to do is give you three different perspectives. And for you to get these perspectives, I need your imagination. I need you to lean into them with me. You need to feel them to understand it. The first one is this. Imagine, what if someone tried to harm someone you love? Tried to physically harm someone you love. I was thinking through examples of this. What would be a good example? I thought about my wife, Lindsay, and I thought, well, if somebody tried to physically harm her, I would definitely step in, but she'd probably kick their butt, and I wouldn't have to. So I was like, oh, she's too strong. This is not a good example. So then I thought about our friends, Brian and Abby, with their new baby, Sammy. I was like, what if somebody tried to physically harm Sammy? My family loves Sammy. Would you step in and try to stop them? Or would you do nothing? Stepping in to protect and defend and to punish the offender is love and justice. It's an act of love and justice. And actually doing nothing is evil. If you are witnessing someone who is vulnerable being harmed and you do nothing, that is an act of evil. And so delivering justice and all these things is an act of love. And so in the same way, when God steps in to judge those who are doing harm is an act of love and a representation of his character of justice. What if God did nothing? That wouldn't be very loving. And so you get one little glimpse that, and what we learn from this, because we can all feel that, if you thought of someone you love and if someone tried to hurt them, I guarantee you would respond. You would at least meet the force with equal amount of force, and some may go further. But what that shows us is God's judgment is a response to love, and it is love. Second thing I want you to imagine living in a world without any justice. Imagine living in a world where people could do whatever they wanted to do without consequence. That's a scary place to be. Imagine living in that world, a place where you could lie and you always get away with it. You could steal with no consequence. You could commit violence against another human being without consequence. You could rape someone that you wanted to rape. Human trafficking would be okay. Murder would be okay without consequence. And my question to you is, would you want to live in that kind of world? I don't think anybody wants to live in that kind of world. And if you're like me and you're full of questions, you're like, well, is the world kind of like that now? Partially. Partially now. What we see now is a glimpse of justice taking place in the world through human institutions, but it's not perfect. A world without justice would be only chaos and destruction, because God's judgment is necessary for peace to exist. It's necessary for human flourishing. If there is no judgment, there is no peace, and there is no human flourishing, there's only chaos and destruction. And the good news of the gospel is that one day Jesus is going to return and make all things right. That's what justice is, fairness. He's going to remove evil from the earth and punish it. He's going to establish his rule, which is just. It's for human flourishing. And he's going to rule in fairness. That is the hope of the gospel. When we look around and we go, man, I see those things in this world, but one day he's coming. But my point is this, is you don't want to live in a world without judgment. As harsh as judgment is, you don't want to live in that world. So then I'm still thinking, because those are two examples to consider. But then I'm still thinking about the emotion of God's anger, his wrath, because we can explain the need for his judgment. But what about the fact that he's angry and he's like going after to punish those who rebel against him? This next one helps me understand this. Imagine the world from God's perspective. Because we like to imagine the world from our perspective. Like, how many people have you talked to, and maybe you struggle with this, where it's like, I can't worship a God who does that. And we put God on trial. How can God be loving if he acts this way? We put him on trial. But what I want to do is pause that argument for a second and pause your perspective for a second and go, let's think about this from God's perspective. God, Genesis 1, 2, and 3 tells us God created everything we see and cannot see. He created a beautiful world, and he did it as an act of love. And then his creation, humanity, not only rebelled against him. This is all in Romans 1. Humanity's response was to rebel against him and his way of life. That would be bad enough. But not only did they rebel, this is the ultimate sin, they replaced him as God and worshiped the things that God made. Romans 1 says they traded the glory of God for his creation. That is the essence of sin. Sin is not just lying. Lying is an expression of rebelling against God and making an idol with something he made. And so God created this beautiful world, and then humanity has refused to obey him, and we've replaced him. What was God's response to this? God's response was first to step into the mess through Jesus Christ. John 3:16 tells us, for God loved the world so much, he sent his son into the world to live a perfect life so he could be an acceptable sacrifice. Then he died, he gave his life on the cross as a sacrifice for your sin and my sin, for humanity's sin. Then he was miraculously raised from the dead, conquering the grave. And because of that, God offers salvation as a gift to everyone that has rebelled against him. It's like there's a war going on, and he's like, hey, there's a free offer to come to my side. All you got to do is call out to the name of the Lord, and you will be saved because you're about to be conquered. And so that offer of salvation is for everyone. And anyone who refuses his love and mercy of salvation gets what they deserve in a double portion. So you can't talk about God's judgment without talking about his mercy, because his mercy is sprinkled throughout the whole scripture. His love and his mercy is the amplified message, but judgment is necessary. Judgment is an act of love. His emotion is because his creation has been abused, harmed, used for selfish gain. And he's a living being, so he's responding. I get mad when something breaks in my kitchen because I want it to be clean. Imagine if you had the power to create a beautiful world and these beautiful creatures, and then they rebelled against you. I'd probably say more cuss words than I said about a coffee cup being broken. Y'all are like judging me. Oh, pastor. Oh. So consider that as you ask that question, how do we resolve the tension of God's love and his judgment? You see it in those examples. And so the summary is this: is God's judgment is a loving response to the evil in the world. And I would say that if he didn't respond with judgment, would it actually be love? Because he'd be giving up his responsibility. And so two more points quickly is this, is to summarize this, because we said, what's the overall message of Revelation 14? God's judgment is real for anyone who doesn't know God. But his love and mercy is available to everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's available. And so I want to highlight that, because we forget it's real. We can't ignore it. It's his coming judgment is going to happen. Whether it happens when you die or when Jesus returns, whichever one happens first. But it's not just about you. It's for anyone that doesn't know him. And so this is true for your family that doesn't know him. Because judgment is real for your family that doesn't know him, your friends that don't know him, your neighbors, your coworkers that don't know him. And there is no soft alternative reality. This is reality, and we have to be aware of it. I don't necessarily like it, but this is reality. Because sometimes in my head, when I think about my friends that I love that don't know God, I just say, well, they're just doing their thing. They're just living their life. And that is true. You can't convince someone to know God. But we all have a job to tell them at least what we know. We have a job to let them know about reality. And so we need to believe this point that his judgment is real, and that's what John's doing in Revelation. He's saying, hey, you know, you're busy with your life, you're pursuing your career, you're building your family, you're excited, maybe you're dating and you're excited about a married future. Maybe you're single and you're going, God, please send me someone. And you're like, do I have faith in this? And, you know, I don't have the answer, sorry. But no matter where you are, you're focused on these things in the world. And John's going, hey, hold up. Let's just take a moment on Sunday morning and let's think about a bigger reality than those important things on earth right now. You need to understand the reality of God's judgment. And so we also need to understand and believe the reality of the good news of salvation that's available for all who call on his name. So two questions as we leave here. First, have you called on the name of the Lord for salvation? Have you done that? Many of you have, but some of you are still searching. You're still wrestling with different things, and that's okay. God can handle your doubts. But I do want to urge you to make sure you're leaning in to the wrestling match. I want to encourage you to lean into your doubts, to have conversations, to be completely honest about your hang-ups. But what's more important is that you're having conversations. You're not just pushing the ball down the field or the road or whatever the analogy that works for that. You're not putting it off. But you need to lean into it. And if you have called on the name of the Lord, I know many of you have, and I have, and what this message does for me is it makes me so grateful that I did not do anything to earn this. It reminds me that I am a sinner, and I'm full of sin, and I'm slowly being transformed into the image of Christ, very slowly. But God's mercy and his love has been given to me, and his name is on my forehead. And therefore, I'm secure in him, and I will be preserved till the end. That gives me comfort, but it makes me so thankful. And I think I want to encourage you, don't ever feel like, oh, you're really just crushing your Christianity. Really got it all figured out. You did all the hard stuff back 15 years ago. Now you just coast and live your life, and it'll all work out. Let your gratitude for God's love and mercy push you forward into life. And then the last question is this, is does your family and your friends know the reality of God's coming judgment? Have you done your part to let them know, hey, it's hard to understand, hey, it's hard to see, but there is more than meets our eyes right now. There's an alternate reality going on. Have you had that conversation? And also, have you shared the other side, the incredible love and mercy of God with them? You know, the judgment is necessary, I think, to get you thinking. But fear will not sustain your whole life. If your Christianity is motivated by the fear of God, by messing up, that's a hard life. That's not the easy yoke of Christ. Fear needs to wake you up and go, whoa, I didn't think about that. That's intense. We need to talk about this. But it's love and mercy that will sustain your relationship with Christ. And you can tell if somebody's walking in fear or walking in mercy and love. And so if you are struggling with fear, you need to transition to the love and mercy. Fix your mind on the love and mercy. There's a place for the fear, but it cannot sustain your whole walk. But have you at least let people know that you love and care about the reality of both God's judgment and his great love? That is one of the heaviest thoughts and conversations. I don't say this lightly. Because that is our part of the responsibility, is the communication of it. We can't change anyone's heart. That's God's job. But have we gotten over ourselves and our fear of being mocked or whatever, or being too pushy? You know, just to have a conversation for those we love. So let's close, and I want you to just close as we thinking about the reality of God's judgment, but also the reality of his great love and his mercy for anyone who calls on the name of the Lord. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for your grace. Thank you that we can all freely admit our sin and our shortcoming, that we don't have to hide because you already know it. And your first response is not judgment. Your first response is mercy and grace, and to point a different pathway forward. But God, let us not ignore your second response to anyone who refuses, which is judgment. Help us to allow that to develop a healthy fear in our hearts of how good your grace is, and never take it for granted. And let it motivate us to not be slack or lazy as we follow you, but let it motivate us to be passionate about your name, passionate about our love for you. And I pray that our words and action will follow that passion because of how much you've loved us and you continue to love on us. Thank you so much. In Jesus' holy name, amen. If you'd like to talk about this, we have some people in the back there by the prayer room who would love to talk with you. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Otherwise, let's stand up and praise God for his great mercy for all who believe in him. Actually, false start. You may have a seat. Where is Bill and Karen Holmes? We're going to send off some friends of ours. Come on up here. Y'all give it up for Bill and Karen Holmes. We want y'all to sing a solo as you leave town. It's your last service to the church. Oh, you'll be here one more time. We'll get you next week. So Bill and Karen have been members of the church for a while. They've been here a couple years and just been a great part of our community. And they have made some life changes. They're moving up to the Cary area to go be closer to grandchildren and to be able to help out with their grandchildren. And so what we want to do is just thank you guys for being part of our church community. Thank you for all the ways that you've gave and you've served and just been friends to all the different people here. So we don't want to neglect that or just want to just mark that moment. And so we also want to pray for you guys and ask that God would just go before you. So if you'll let me let's pray. Pray with me, please. Father God, thank you so much for Bill and Karen. Thank you for all the ways you've blessed their life. Thank you for just their participation here at Live Oak Church. We just love having their presence here and all the ways they've been a part. They've been a gift to our community. I pray that you would go before them as they make this move, be with them in all the details. I pray that you would establish them in the new community they're moving to. Pray that you would provide them with a loving church community for them. I pray that these next few years with their grandchildren would just be full of sweet, sweet memories. And I pray that it would just be an absolute gift for their children. And we just pray that you would protect them and go before them. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen to that.
All right, guys.
Thank you, Brian.
Y'all give it up for them.
Appreciate it.